and asked me to stop anywhere, and we'll proceed now. Okay. So what we have with us is, I did ask everyone to have this IFE design suit, 14.7. So this one, you have to double click this one simply. The very first step is that. Carefully listen, a few queries have come on WhatsApp to demonstrate how to write a test bench. So that, for that reason, I am today demonstrating as the first agenda of today's task, a demonstration of this, how to write a test bench. Second will be parameters discussion. So once you open this ISE, this tip of the day will come. You can uncheck this one, show tips at startup. This, if you uncheck the, from second time onwards, when you double click this one, ISE integrated software environment, it will not be coming to you. So this one, about this, that is a brief. So let us start with a fresh project. You go to file. First step is go to file. If I'm anywhere, if I'm speeding up, please, don't type anything in the chat window, because I have to go from all the way from here to that meet tab and then chat window. So instead that, you unmute yourself and talk to me, that you go slow, sir. So I will go slow. So just go to file and then new project. Here, this wizard will come. New project wizard will come. In this new project wizard, what you have to do is you just type your anything that is you are looking for. Suppose say MUX, we are 2x1. For a demonstration purpose, we'll take a smaller one, MUX 2x1. And this location here is already set in my system. If you want to have any way, this, you see here three dots here. Can someone confirm whether you are able to see this screen? Someone there, yes, unmute and tell, is this visible?
Yes, sir, visible.
Yeah, it's
okay, visible. Okay, thank you. So these dots, you just click them and it will prompt you anywhere. Suppose, say, for example, I want to go here somewhere in the if in your system is D drive available. So you can click, you can pick that drive. Suppose for in this case, E I am picking. And if you want to make any folder inside here, you click on make new folder. That way you can choose this location. That is one thing that you can do. This is the location for your project files. Location for your project files. And the working directory during the simulation, during synthesis, several files will be generating, tool will be generating. So all those files, you don't want to cluster them with your actual design file and test bench file. In that case, you can put them in a separate folder. So for that, this working directory is there. Okay. So now let us go to next. This default, last time I took up this for discussion, again, I'm not going to talk about this schematic, electronic design, information interchange format, native generic circuit, about them, I'm not going to talk about this. And moreover, these are not required also now. So as a part of this course, only HDL is required. So let us go to HDL. And as an industry practice, what we are doing, on which date we are doing, who is the engineer doing, all that go in this description area, this where I'm typing here, this description area. So all that will go as a industry practice. So since we are not going to do any sort of industrial activities, so let us just skip this description and go to next. And here, this portion also I explained once in the last session, that you have this evaluation board. There are several from the vendor has Kintec 7, Arctic 7, Vortex 6, all that boards are available. So currently, if you are working, let us say Kintec 7 evaluation platform is your target board, then you have to set that one and then proceed. If you don't have any such any other, so for example, if you have Spartan 3 starter board, then select that and go ahead. Likewise. So if that is not there, then I mean, for us, for our purpose, we are just skipping this portion here and go to this product category. This also I explained last session without wasting much time here. We'll go straight to the demand. Demand is WhatsApp request is to demonstrate how to write test bench. That's the WhatsApp request. So that's why let us rush to that one. But meanwhile, this also required for those newly joined candidates here. So for that purpose, I'm just running through all this. So I have this board with me, Spartan 3E, and I have device that is there with me is a 500E. And the package that is available with this device is FG320. And the speed that board I am having with me, let us say -5. What is the speed? What is package? What is device? What is this family? What is this product? Everything I spoke in the last video are available. Those who missed the classes, they can check the video links I am sharing in WhatsApp group so that you can check. So about these details, those who are newly joined here, they can refer to the recorded videos. Let us go to this next and then finish. So here you see this hierarchy, and in this you have the project name here and the device. Now what I do is I right click here and I go to the new source. There are several ways to go to this new source wizard here. This also I demonstrated last time. One is right clicking here and going to this one. The other is picking from here. The other is from project and the new source. So from all these three ways, you will get the same new source wizard. So this last time I demonstrated. Those who missed can go to that link shared in the WhatsApp group. So I am going to type MUX2x1. So this is my file name. So and the Verilog module, never ever give the shortcut for Verilog HDL as a VHDL, and don't select this VHDL module. If somebody is selecting and trying to practice Verilog course, they will mess up everything because tool will generate a template related to VHDL language. The VHDL language is a separate HDL. This also given in demonstration in earlier classes if you refer the earlier recorded videos. So now go to the Verilog module. So ensure that this is checked here. Go to the next and go to next and then finish. So here, this template here, in this area, you see tabs here, MUX2x1.v and design summary. So these are the tabs here. I'm switching between the tabs here. And my mouse is here. Do you see where I'm hovering my mouse? So here, this description area we did not fill. That's why this entire thing is empty. Company is empty, engineer name is empty, and design name is empty. So all these are empty here. The design, that description earlier when we were creating this project, we did not fill this one. So that's why this is everything is empty. Just I'm removing this one here because it's not required for us. Now coming to the backcode time scale, 1 nanosecond/1 picosecond. Guys, this is compiler directive. Why compiler directive is required, that itself is a separate discussion I will take up in next sessions. But for now, I am just removing this compiler directive. And now this is where the template, in this template, I am just going to put this one here. That is, you know, I have the black box here. This is my black box. I have my input A. I have my input B. I have my input select line. Yes. And my output Y. So this is what I know. Inside what is there, if I am not aware, then I go to one abstract level in the Verilog HDL. That abstract level is a behavioral level modeling. So the guys there, I have shared with you people the syllabus contents. This is there in our schedule, somewhere in unit 5 or unit 4. At that time, we will discuss. You don't need to bother about what is behavioral level modeling at this point. But already we have taken a few, you know, tri-state gates. We have taken a few examples of BuffIF 1 and BuffIF 0. So since we discussed them earlier classes, BuffIF 0, how they work, we can use them to build this inside what is there. Because for us, the functionality is known. The functionality is when your S is 0 and output that you want is A. And when S is 1, output that you want on Y is B. So what is Y? It is known to you. This one you can derive. You can derive Y as A S bar plus B S. Since this is a smaller example, you are not going to this behavioral right now. You are not targeting this behavioral level modeling. According to our given syllabus, it is there in the fourth unit. But as you are familiar with this tri-state gates, you can use them to develop this behavior. This is one point. The second point, we also have seen our primitives, gate level primitives. So them also you can use and you can obtain this behavior. So either way, using either tri-state gates is one approach. One approach is you use tri-state gate to build this behavior. The other approach is, you know, gate level primitives already discussed, refer previous recorded videos. We have gate level primitives. So these gate level primitives also you can use. So but here the request that has come from many is to demonstrate how to write test page. So let us not bother about at this point in which abstract level we are coding. At this point, we are trying to focus how to write test page. Okay, so let us go to this port declaration. This area is called port declaration. I'll zoom bit here. The F8. So this is area. This area where I am hovering my mouse is a port list area. All ports you can this one. I said some yesterday or some other day. I said that this is primary inputs, and I said that here you have a primary outputs. Even this is a part of primary input. So the difference between primary inputs and primary outputs and intermediate inputs and intermediate outputs, about them also I took up yesterday's session or the day before yesterday. In the recorded videos, it is there, you kindly refer. So the point is, the point that I am making here is, we have to have here only primary inputs and primary outputs. That's the point that I am making here. So you have here A, you have B, you have your that select line, and then output line is Y. So this is what the ports that are available for your design. Right now, the design that you have taken, for that, these are the ports. So this area is called port list area. Now what you can do is input A comma B comma S, and then semicolon, and then you put output, and then Y. So this one here, it's a keyword. Input is a keyword, output is a keyword. And A, B, S, all are scalar type. That's why we are going with this only one input. If S would have been a vector type, then we would have skipped here and separately one more input, and then we would have written that scalar type. So at this point, but anyway, you don't bother. I will take those examples later on. But at this point, you just focus what I'm doing. That is the test bench development is the agenda, actually. So now assign is a data flow construct. We have several constructs. In the previous sessions, I said we have switch level is the lowest level abstraction level, switch level in the very largest here. Then comes gate level. Then comes data flow level. Then comes behavioral level. Then comes structural level. Then there is another called mixed level. Either of this, all this so far listed, we can mix them. So that is called mixed level abstraction. That way also possible in the Verilog HDL. So, but at this stage, this assign is a data flow level construct. So I am just going with that. Why is assigned when yes is true? Question mark is a yes is whether true. That is what ternary operator. I will just put a comment here. This is a ternary operator. Now see, it is there. So it's a ternary operator. If yes is true, meaning yes is one, then first statement will be executed. Whatever you put here, that will be executed. So I am just putting the B. I just want to assign B to this one. And then colon, in case if yes is false, after this colon, whatever is there, that will be executed. So my intention is here A should go to the void. So that's why I'm putting A. I have done with my description here. So I have to terminate every statement in the Verilog HDL. See, first statement is terminated with a semicolon. Last statement is also terminated, second statement. Third statement with semicolon. Fourth statement with semicolon. We have to terminate with semicolon. But remember, the final statement, end module. So this will not be terminated with a semicolon. So that is the syntax, what we call language syntax. So we have done this design file description. This is called design file. Now what we do is, we have to develop test bench. So for developing test bench, as I said here earlier sessions, recorded videos, if you see, I have with me this design. This design has got some primary inputs and some primary outputs. This design has got some primary inputs and some primary outputs. These are primary outputs and these are primary inputs. Now, what is my idea is, I just want to run the simulation. For running the simulation, what I have to ensure, I have to ensure that all possible cases are taken into consideration. That is the point number one. And at which interval, which input is going? That is the second thing that I have to take into consideration. Meaning, I have to have timing diagrams. Without timing diagrams, guys, remember that you cannot develop your test bench. These timing diagrams are essential. Every industry will follow this one. Industry guys will follow these timing diagrams. Without this timing diagram, they will not develop the test bench. So here, if this is a very starting time, let us say t equal to 0. And at t equal to 1, I am just talking about time units. I am not associating any time with this 1 and this 2. I am not associating any time. Associating time means this, millisecond, nanosecond, like that. Time I am not associating, seconds, like that. Time I am not associating. I am saying it's a time unit. This is a simply time unit. I am not talking about which unit it is. Unit means this, either of this one here, milliseconds, nanoseconds, seconds, is a actually unit. So since I'm not mentioning, I'm simply saying time unit. So at this time unit, what is that I have here? Suppose say I have A, I have my B, I have my, in this taken example, current example. So what is my A? What is my B? What is my S? So based on this even here inputs here, what would be my output? What would be my output? That who has to decide? As a designer, as a verification engineer, designer will not bother actually in the industry. Guys, this designer will only develop the code. In industry, if you talk about that itself will take a discussion, but let us not have a discussion today. Some other day we'll put this discussion. Design guys are different in industry. Design guys are different. And verification guys are different. So this design guy, but still design guy, what he knows is the functionality design guy knows. Functionality design guy is familiar with functionality. based on, since specification, functionality means what I mean, more precisely, specifications. Design guy is familiar with the specifications. That's why he or she able to develop the code. And equally, verification guy also familiar with the specification. That's why he could able to verify whether this design developed by this design engineer is meeting the required specification requirements or not. That's why this verification engineer can able to verify. But at this point, I mean that learning stage, we only will be designers and we only will be verification engineers. At the learning stage, we are the verification engineers and we are also design engineers. But in the industry, it is not like that. Okay, guys. So coming to the point here, I was just emphasizing that you must know timing diagrams. Those guys who requested me on WhatsApp to talk about, give a demonstration for how to develop what we call this test bench, pay attention clearly. Timing diagrams is essential. How do you develop timing diagrams? You mark these timings, different timing intervals you mark like that. And you put your, what is your input? What is your other input? What is your other input? Like that, list everything you define here in the timing diagram. For example, in this timing diagram, initially I don't know what is my A is. Now I am going to put here 2 out, I am going to put 0, let us say. Meaning at this interval it is 0, at this interval it is 0, at this interval also 0. And B, I don't know initially what it is. And throughout, I'm going to put from here 1, let us say, everything is 1. 1, 1. Now, yes, initially, I don't know anything. But from here on, first 0, and then going to 1, and then 0. Let us say, this way I plan. So this is 0, this is 1, this is. So from this, as a verification engineer, we can say that, this is actually the specification. For that, when this is 0, this is expected onto the Y. So what is my A 0? Since this is S is 0, A is expected on Y. So my 0 is expected. Now, as a verification engineer, now I go to 1 here. I put a 1 here. Now, I see that this time, this shouldn't be on Y. This B should be on Y. So what is my B here I see? Oh, B is 1. So meaning my output is 1. Now again I come back here. This time not 1. This time it is 0 again. So this time it shouldn't be B now. It should be A now. So meaning whatever the A value, that will come here. And that is, this is what required for every design. This timing diagram is required. If you really developing a processor design for your project or any FSM, finite state machine, if you are developing, for example, vending machine, that is your design, you had to have timing diagram for that. Based on this timing diagram, you can develop your test bench. How do you develop your test bench? From timing diagram, remember. So how I am relating timing diagram to the test bench, you will come to know now shortly. So you have done your design here. Now you save your design file. Now go to three ways, possible ways. One is here, this to get this wizard. The other is from the project, new wizard, or directly right click and go to the new source. Now your Verilog test fixture, you have to take this one. Never ever shortcut from your side Verilog HDL as a VHDL, and don't go to VHDL test bench. Since we are simply saying test benches, array, in this tool you have seen the test bench here. So don't go to the VHDL test bench. VHDL in itself is a language. Again, time and again, I am telling you this. So go to Verilog test fixture and have a file name here. That file name is your test. Now you go to next here. Simply ensure that this is checked here and go to next. Since this also I said in the previous lecture, that since currently only one design, it is reflecting here only one design. If there would have been several designs in the project, this project, this is some arithmetic logic project, let us say ALU instead of MUX 2x1, let us say this is ALU, meaning what? Arithmetic and logic units. In arithmetic itself, we have adder, subtractor, and division and multiplication, whatnot. There are several arithmetic units, right? So then you are developing one by one here, let us say. So now you see the list here. That is, the one is for subtractor, the other is for multiplier, the other one is for a division, like that. So now if you are developing a test bench for the divider circuit, a divider you have to pick here in the listed, and click that, this blue bar will come onto that divider. Then go to the next. Since the current project is having only one design, you will be seen here only one blue bar. Click that, simply next, and then finish. That's it. So now this tool has generated for you a template. Here you see the template. In this template, this is again, this is industry standard. One has to fill this, because that is for, if you are going it's a huge project. If you are giving this project to your juniors, they will go through that and they will understand who initiated project and all. So now coming to guys, those who requested on the WhatsApp, keep attention carefully here. We are now in the test bench. This is the agenda of today's. So in this test bench, carefully observe your inputs. These identifiers A, B, S in the design file. You have this in the with a keyword input. All these identifiers, this A, B, S, those identifiers with the keyword input, all they have become reg here. Why? I will tell that. I'll take up that later on. I'm just finding where the zoom is and zoom so that now it's fine. So this all identifiers A, B, S, all these are declared with a reg here. You didn't type by default. When you have created the test bench, tool has generated for you this template. But in this template, what we are noting is this one. We are noting these inputs, instead of keyword input here, they have become a reg. And similarly, in the design file, if you go and see those identifiers with the keyword output, they have become in the test bench wire. That's the thing, it's the essential point number one that is to be noted. Point number one. Even before this, there's a point number one here. This is the point number one, and this is the point number two. Point number one is this. This test bench hasn't got any here, this sort of list. Port list is not there with a test bench. Simply, and that name that you gave, whatever the name that you want to give to this test bench module, you can give. Since we gave the file name test with the name file name, this tool has generated template for you with the test. It has used that file name itself as a module. So guys, here the point number one to be noted is this test bench file will not have port list. This is the point one. Point two is this one. Inputs, all input identifiers will become reg. All output identifiers will become wire. That is the point number two. Point number three is this instantiate the unit under test. You see this portion carefully, MUX 2x1. The same we used in the test bench, the design file. This one, MUX 2x1. That is MUX 2x1. This module name, this module. So the same module name here, you see in the test bench file here, you have this MUX 2x1. That is the one observation. The other observation is, this has got something called UUT. That is unit under test. This is user defined. You can have anything here, CUT, DUT, anything. But remember, that should be in line with some technical terms, such as if you have CUT, it's a component under test. If you have DUT, design under test. If you have UUT, it's a unit under test. But you cannot have here your name or my name. That is something abnormal, it's not fair enough. So the what is fair enough is this technical term. So that is the one observation that we have to make. The other observation is, here you see the dot and this name, and the dot this name, dot this name, dot this name. This is called port binding or port mapping or port association. In previous videos, recorded videos are there. We discussed elaborately there. Guys, there you please refer. This is a binding. We are binding. In fact, dot or soon after dot, whatever the identifier is there, actually this identifier itself is there in this MUX 2x1 design module. If you see your this one here, you have in this these identifiers A, B, S, Y. Carefully observing the test bench, they are soon after dot. But inside the parenthesis, these in the test bench file, these identifiers, they can be anything A1, but A1 should come here. Remember that. So that's what this we took up elaboratively in the previous recorded videos. Kindly go through. So that is port mapping and port binding and port association. And this sort of port mapping is called, there are two types. One is a positional, the other is a named binding. And this is called named binding. And industry uses named binding only, no positional binding. So now coming to this, this is the critical, and this is the actual main important thing that needs to be discussed. Guys, those who requested to demonstrate test bench, there are several ways to write a test bench. There are several ways, guys. As you go along with this course, you will be getting the familiarity. But currently, what I am going to do is, I will explain everything here, just removing this template generated, and I will explain what we are doing here. So let us say everything is just we are removing nothing. Now, what I do is, I use a procedural construct called initial. This is called procedural construct. This comes in behavioral level coding or behavioral constructs. What is behavioral level construct? What is meant by procedural construct and all? In the unit 4 or unit 5, according to the given syllabus, we'll learn that. At this stage, you have to understand that initial is a procedural construct. Point number one. And it is used in most of the times, it is found in test benches. Instead design file, it is found in test benches. This is the point number two. Why and all, everything in subsequent classes, you will understand. At this stage, you don't bother about that. Now, what it does is, inside this initial, we can have loops, for loop like that, while loop like that, case statements we can have. Several things are possible. Without initial, I just cannot have, for example, if I remove this initial and I put for and something like I equal to 0 and then semicolon, I less than or equal to 3 and then I equal to I plus 1. Like that, I am giving and running. Then this is going to throw error here. Because the language is so made that this loop should come inside the initial or always. Initial, or there is another procedural construct called always. So the language is so defined that inside this procedural construct, these two are called procedural constructs. Inside procedural constructs only, this loop will come. Language is so defined like that. That's why we, if you want to have loops or case statements or if else like that, so you have to have under initial or always. Remember, this is the point that is to be remembered. And we will learn in a behavioral level unit more elaborately. At this stage, that is enough. Now, what I'm going to do is, after this initial, if I have only one statement, let us say that is A equal to 0. This is one statement. If only there is a one statement, then that is okay. Now, currently what you see, that is okay. But if I have the other one also, this is second statement. So now how many statements are there? Two statements. So two statements cannot be like this. We have to have begin and after this last statement end, begin and end are required. This is the other observation that you have to remember. Initial comes in the test benches most of the times. Initial is a procedural construct. Inside the initial, we can have if, else like that, case statements like that, for loops, while loop like that. Them we can have only inside the procedural construct. What is procedural construct? Our initial or always. Why it is so like that? Language is defining that way. Is that clear? So, can guys, if you have doubts, you can unmute. Otherwise, kindly I request to mute somebody. Okay, so just removing this. So just explaining why this initial. The guys asked, what is that? How to develop the test bench? So now let us start with the, what is that we have now? I said that the timing diagrams are required. Guys, there. Those who are already familiar have to bear with me. And this is the session for those guys who requested on WhatsApp to explain test bench development. So here in this timing diagram, initially, meaning a time equal to zero, what we have? We have a time equal to zero, we have this A0, B1, yes sir, zero, at a time equal to zero. At time one, we have T still zero, and B1 still B1 and E, but yes change. So then we are going to now put here in the test bench. How we are going to put in the test bench, that you see. So now I am going to put, not visible. Guys, there, is it visible? No, okay. Your screen is still visible to others. Click to cancel your presentation. I don't know why it has gone into the you people have to immediately respond. I was just continuing actually. I don't know how come.
Oh, it's
but till what point you people have seen here? I was talking about initial, I was talking about always, I was talking about for loop, while loop. Have you seen everything there in the here at this point? At this point. Somebody please unmute and
everything is visible. Everything
So far
till
so
now
far, what?
Till now it is
visible. So far
it is visible.
Okay. So far what all I have discussed, everything you have seen, no?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, thank you. So now in case guys there, I request if suddenly it is going in invisible, you kindly unmute and talk to me, because I just seen it has gone in what we call, that is a pause, share pause, something. Okay, back here. So I was talking about this timing. Why this is required? Those guys who are not familiar with test bench development, why I am stressing on timing diagram? And guys, you also get into touch with those who are working in the industry. They emphasize on this timing diagram. Without timing diagram, a verification engineer will not be a verification engineer. Okay, so let us come to this point. Our point now. So, but the point here I'm making is, you start with the begin, because you know that you have several statements to put here. That is, one is A, you have to put B, you have to put S, you have to put so several statements. That's why you know that you are going to have several statements. That's why you start with a begin. Now I am putting here A as 0 and B as 0 and my S as 0. So where I am carrying out, since I did not mention any time here at this point, everything is treated in the simulator like a zero simulation. Simulator has got the timings. That is by default a zero simulation time. Which one here I'm talking about? I will pick some other color here. This guy there, this one is a zero simulation time. At this zero simulation time, I have my A0 here, starting from here at this zero. At starting at zero, I have B1. starting at 0, I have my S0. So 0, 1, 0, where at t equal to 0. That exact thing here, A0, B0, S0. Now, the thing that you notice is, I was telling that this is a some time unit. This time unit, let us say now, I just want to have 5 time unit delay. So the hash is a delay control operator. Guys, there, those who are not familiar with the language, hash is a, in the Verilog SDL, hash is a delay control operator. So hash 5 means simulator will go till 5, from 0 to 5, and there it will alter things whatever I am dictating to the compiler. I am going to dictate to the compiler that I want this behavior, that at this, let us say I am making it as a 5, and at this point I want this to be 1. And there you don't see any changes between your 0 and 1. It's still continued. These are still continued. Only this is changing. Yes, is changing. So that's why at 5 time unit, my S is becoming 1. In case if A would have been changing, then I would have put even A here. That's how. Now you go to the next one. Let us go to again this one here. At this stage, what I'm going to make is, I'm going to make another 5 units delay here. This is another 5 units delay. So at this point, meaning at T0, this is 5, meaning it is 10. It is 10, right? 10. So 0, 5 unit time delay I am making means it is obviously 5 plus 5 meaning 10. Meaning this is cumulatively added. Cumulatively meaning hash, I cannot put 10. If I put 10, what happens is 5 plus 10, that is becomes 15. At 15, I am going to define something. I don't want to define at 15. I want to define at 10. So already 5 is delayed. Another 5 I put, then that is okay. So at that time, S equal to 0 I am making according to my timing diagram. So now I have done with my timing diagram requirements here. I have done with my timing diagram requirement. That's why timing diagrams are required before developing the test bench. So since this is a simple example, MUX example, simple example, you may not be noticing that much importance to the timing diagram. But if you are developing a CPU, after all, a 8-bit processor CPU, a small and with some four instructions, with some I/O instructions alone only, not memory related. In that case, how important this timing diagram, you will understand. Even for that matter, you don't need to go to the even CPU, 8-bit CPU. You just take your, booth multiplication algorithm. Then also you'll understand how important timing diagrams are. So, but anyway, back here. That's how, guys, you are developing the test bench based on your timing diagram. It is not just from your mind. If you do from your mind, then you will mess up. This is a simple example. You feel like, array, I can do it, nothing like that. But if you take huge example, complex example, you will understand the importance of the timing diagram. So since you have done, you're defining all stimulus or test vectors, now what you can do is, you can put an end module here. You can put a guys, there anyone having doubts or what? Somebody unmuting.
Sir, I have one doubt.
Yes.
Which one is synthesizable, sir? Either DUT or test bench?
Synthesizable is a test DUT only. This one. Can you see this one? Can you see this where I'm hovering my mouse now?
Oh, yes, sir. I'm able to see.
Yeah. This one is a synthesizable, this one.
Sir, why not the test bench is not synthesizable, sir?
Why not test bench is synthesizable means there are tools. Again, I spoke about this in a second session or first session. Synthesizable, who is actually supporting us? I will go to here, this one. Let me go to this one here. I will tell just a moment. You have your code. This is your code. I will tell why not. I will tell you. This is your code. in this code, what is that you are expecting? You are expecting you wrote some English-like language, and this is called your behavior. You don't know what that circuit demands, internal connections and all, everything you don't know. You only know is a behavior of the circuit. This behavior in English-like language you have coded, and that English-like language I am calling it as a HDL, hardware description language. Now my idea is, from this behavior of the code, I have to develop a gate level netlist. I want to develop my hardware. Gate level netlist, nothing but hardware, just all that flip flops, gate, what is the interconnection between them, all such information is your gate level netlist. So this netlist I want to obtain. Who is going to help me? Me going to help a tool called synthesizer. A tool called synthesizer is going to. Now this synthesizer, who is developing? EDA companies are developing. Electronic Design Automation Tool developers. EDA. Electronic Design Automation. Industry fellows are developing. Few famous are Cadence and your Synopsys and your Xilinx, Mentor Graphics, all these are players in this IC, EDA tool. So now this Cadence fellow will develop a EDA tool. This Cadence fellow will develop a EDA tool. This EDA tool will have some manual telling that this HDL constructs only, suppose say HDL has got 100 constructs, suppose, just I'm telling you for understanding purpose, 100 constructs are there in the HDL. Among these 100, only 66 are supported by this tool. This tool is from where, whom? from Cadence. Guys, unmute. Somebody who's in a unmute state can mute. Kindly mute. If you have question at that time, you can unmute and talk. But currently now I'm explaining you, please, I request you mute yourself. Okay. So now this Cadence fellow has given an EDA tool, and EDA tool is the one which helps us by taking the HDL code as an input. And it will give us this hardware gate level netlist without manual development. So now this fellow, Cadence fellow, will say, in this HDL has got 100 constructs. For understanding purpose, let us say I have only 100 constructs. Now this fellow say, I can support only 66 constructs. And using them, if you write any behavior, this behavior, using only this 66, if you develop, my tool will give you this gate level netlist. One fellow telling, Cadence fellow telling. But Synopsys fellow, these are competitors. Synopsys fellow will tell, "Arey Baba, I can give you for 86 constructs. What I can give you? If you use 86 constructs and develop a behavior level code for your hardware, and give to my synthesizer means whose synthesizer? Synopsys tool synthesizer. I will give you the gate level. Who is telling this? Yes, Synopsys fellow telling. Now there is a Mentor Graphics fellow. He will come, he will say, no, you can, I will support 96 constructs of the language. So likewise, different fellows are telling a different constructs I will support. Support means what? Support means using them, if you describe your hardware functionality, my tool that is called synthesizer, this synthesizer will generate a gate level netlist. That is the point. Okay. Now, if you write the test bench, coming to your question here, this test bench may not have all constructs supported by the tool. Point number one is test bench may not have all constructs supported by this synthesizer tool. Point number one. Point number two. there are tools in the market. They say in the test bench itself, if you give us, then we can generate for you that gate level netlist. There are very few that Simplify or some other vendor like Xilinx, Mentor Graphics, CAD and Synopsys. There is a Simplify, I guess. Tomorrow I will tell the vendor name. What that vendor claims is, from the test bench itself, why you write the behavioral level code, why you write behavioral level code, and then why you go to the test bench? You write straight test bench itself. I am there for you to give you the gate level netlist. There is another vendor, the way Xilinx is there, the way Mentor Graphics is there, the way Cadence is there, the way Synopsys is there. There is another fellow vendor, EDA vendor, this EDA vendor, who says that you give, I will support. That is another scenario. But the basic fundamental principle or fundamental answer, most of the times, 99% or 95%, this 95% most of the times, why test bench is not synthesizable? The answer is, all the constructs that are used in the test bench are not supported by the synthesizer. Is that clear? Whether your question been answered or not?
Yeah, it is.
Okay. So, are there any more doubts? Guys, are there any more doubts? Okay, what
do you think? I have a doubt.
Okay. Come with your doubt.
You said like some vendors, you said like the name you can say tomorrow. How can we use the test bench actually? If you read the code, what does it mean? Like how the test bench can be synthesized? It doesn't have any code, right? Functionality at all.
I think as far as I understand, because of audio issue, correct me if I am wrong. I took your question this way, that you said if there are tools which can generate from the test bench itself this gate level netlist. How is that happening? That is what your question is. Am I correct in understanding your question?
Yeah, it doesn't have any functionality. Functionality. It doesn't.
For that, we have to consult. Point is, let me take this one. First of all, that tool is so smart. First answer is, tool is EDA tool. That EDA tool is so smart. So smart means, for example, just to give you a vague idea, I will take this example. I am putting my A, I am putting my B, I am putting my S. I am giving a vague idea. So don't take it in a 100% in the sense, don't take it. This is a vague idea. So this is, let us say, 0, this is, let us say, 1. And this is, say, 0, and then for a while 1, then for a while 0, for a while it is 1. So now my intention is actually this interval. If you give this one to the tool, possibly, I understand we have to consult that tool manual itself, and this will understand in that sense that this is zero and sort of line. Several other things will be there. I am telling you, this is the second point that I am telling. One is tool is smart. The second point is, we have to tell other than this information, we also have to have some means in that to tell the tool that this, what is that you are expecting when this happened to be zero. That also we have to feed to the tool, that information also. One is feeding a bench. The second is, we also have to feed to this EDA tool, such EDA tools which are taking test bench itself and to generate a gate level netlist. We also have to feed when this happens, what is that you are expecting? That that information also needs to be fed. So based on these two, then these two algorithms are so smart. They understand that, oh, this is nothing but simply MUX behavior. So this is A and this is B and this is your Y and this is yes. That is what I understand. Further information I don't have. I myself have to consult, but at this stage, at this level of my understanding, what I can tell is those tools are first of all so smart tools. Smart tool means inside these algorithms they are used, they are so sophisticated algorithms that they take one this test bench, they take what is expected. Expected is also required, otherwise the tool cannot predict. If you only give this one, how can tool predict that at this stage that I have to pick only this? There is no possibility. How smart may be that EDI tool, there is no possibility unless you provide not this expected. So if you provide, one is a test bench, the other is not logic, but at this instant of time, this is my expectation, at this instant of time, this is my expectation. That information also, if you give it to the EDI tool, this EDI tool is so sophisticated algorithms it is using. Based on that, it can conclude that it is a sort of behavior, that behavior best fits for this hardware that is called MUX. Likewise, how complex it may be, based on, as I said, one is this, the second is this. Based on that, it is concluding this algorithm, this EDI tool from the test bench itself, what is the hardware required. Here. Yeah, is that clear?
Yeah, it's clear now. Thank you.
Yeah, welcome.
Yeah.
So guys,
clear now. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah, guys, let us finally, we are running short of time. So guys there who asked me yesterday over the class itself that demonstrate how we do this one. I mean, test bench, actually how we develop, what is happening here. The final part I forgot, why it is reg and why it is wire. This is essential. Let me quickly wrap the session with this. I don't know whether earlier is there or not. Oh, earlier gone. Let us take this one very quickly. You have this module. And you are giving some A and some B. And you are getting some output Y. And you are getting some S. But how long this needs to be, preserved? How long? Over the simulation time, it needs to preserve. Your simulation time is starting with 0 and it ending with some time, let us say n. So meaning what? At t0 to 1, some values here. At t1 to some other interval, some values here. At this time interval to some other time interval, some other values. Meaning over the simulation period, that is starting with 0 to n, we have to preserve this input so that we can keep giving to the UUT, unit under test. Am I clear, guys there? Am I clear? Otherwise, how can you give? So this needs to be held somewhere. We have to hold them somewhere. So we are holding. Holding is a property of a reg data type. Holding or preserving is a property of a reg data type. Remember, wire will not hold. Wire property is not to preserve, is not to hold. Wire, what it does, whatever at that instant of time coming at t equal to 0, whatever comes, it will display. It will with at that instant of time. But we are not at that instant of time looking for the outputs here. No, these values are changing over the simulation time. 0 to n, over the simulation time, these values are changing, input values are changing. Changing means at this instant of time, you have to preserve, you have to hold. At this interval, you have to preserve, you have to hold. At this interval, you have to preserve and hold. Who is facilitating that property? Reg data type is facilitating that property. That's why in your test bench, these are declared with a reg and this is wire, because this is not required to true at all, because if you see this one, at this instant of time, whatever comes that we see on the output, why do you preserve whatever that you time equal to 0, 1, 2, 3, depending upon your inputs, whatever that comes, you want to see them. That's it. So the preservation is not required during simulation. Preservation of the stimulus or test vectors is required in the during simulation. That's why, and the property that who is facilitating that, Reg is facilitating that preservation, and that's the reason why in the test bench these input identifiers are declared with a Reg instead of while. That's the answer for that. So with this, we let us wrap today's session. And you know the simulation, how to do the simulation, that already been demonstrated. You have to go to the simulation here, and you have to pick this one here. Let me my Avast antivirus. What it does is causing some problem while running the simulation. That's why I just disabled for 10 minutes. Now I can go to this simulator. I can simply double click this one. If not saved, it will ask to save. So I am just telling yes. So it will run. If there are any errors, it will throw errors here. If no errors, we can see happily that waveform window. And in that wave window, we have to see that whether expected has come or not. That we have to ensure. So this is your this one. Yes is zero at this interval time. At this interval of time, the values are here in the value section. So yes is zero. So what is expected on A, whatever is there, that is expected on the output Y. So that is seen. Now if you go to where yes is one, what is expected, whatever there on the B, that is expected. But what is there on the B, zero is there again. So that we are getting. So that's how you check your simulation. So this one, why it is coming B as a one, I think we gave in this section. Oh, we gave the zero, that's why B is coming as a zero. I thought we have given the B as a one. So 1 minute, guys, before leaving 1 minute, just let us make this as a one. Let us make this as a one and rerun this one. But anyway, earlier also is the correct, because just whatever the value that is there on the net B, that should be seen on the output Y. Exactly that is happening. But just to give you a feel, like how is that happening? Feel is important. So when S is zero, it's zero, and this A is seen on the output. Now come to the S is one. Here S is one, and B is one, and this B is seen on the output. Why? So that's how, guys. Those who asked, I am very sorry. I took 5 minutes more from you. And very unfortunately, we couldn't able to go to the parameters. Parameters are something essential. We have to understand even the parameter concepts. So guys, let us wrap the session. I think you benefited from the today's session as well. So if you have any queries, you can stay here. Otherwise, you can sign off.